Welcome to A Fresh Take. I'm Mark Pennell, along with Paul Sartorelli. Usually, I throw a subject at him, and he's caught off guard and has to come up with some whiz-bang answer.
Which is why the shows are going to be really crazy sometimes.
Yeah, it's true. We kind of like that. But this time, Paul came to me with a subject that he wanted to talk about. And frankly, without sounding like a pun, I was doubtful that we could spend 20 minutes on it. Either you do or you don't.
And I think, we'll see how we go, because we don't have it completely scripted. He's not sure we can do 20 minutes. I'm not sure we can do this in 20 minutes. It's such an important topic
that it really is.
It might take more than one. So hang with us. What's the topic?
Doubt. Okay.
It's a huge subject.
It really is. If there isn't a Christian out there that hasn't doubted, then I'm not too sure they're a believer.
Or they're so saintly. And because maybe, I don't know if you doubt, it'd be interesting to know what you doubt about. But even if you don't, there's not a parent I've ever met who either worries about their children because they're young or worries about their kids because they've gone away to college or now they're adults and they've completely sort of left the church or whatever. And so it's either I'm worried about my doubt or I'm worried about my friend's doubt or my kid's doubt. It's prevalent. It's everywhere.
Matter of fact, my own son, he's just finished college and his views have changed. And hopefully, I'm not saying he's gone away from Christ, but he's asked a lot of questions, and the cool thing is, and you'll get into this, that's a journey he has to take by himself.
Indeed.
And hopefully he'll get back into a real interest in it. Yeah. But I get ahead of myself.
And you said the cool thing, and hear us say this, cool, I'm not sure that's the word I would use, but yes, it's cool, it's natural, it can, I mean, yeah, doubt is human. I mean, we all, think about when you got married. Because I thought about the rehearsal the day before I got married, and I love Sue, and we've been married for 117 years.
Yeah.
Were you 100% sure 3 hours before your wedding or the day before your wedding, or did you have any doubt at all? Like, I don't know if I can do this.
I have more doubt today.
But that's the human thing. We're prone to doubt. And I think the more we get it out there and talk about it, the more we'll be able to deal with it. You know, you just retired, and you've figured it all out, numbers-wise and all of that, and you made your decision. Did you ever doubt, like, oh, maybe I shouldn't have done it? Or
No, actually, I haven't done it. I haven't done it. Yes, I did it initially. But as it soaked in, I realized this is what was supposed to happen.
Okay, good.
For one thing, I was able to now do this. This is something I'd prayed for a long time, just to be able to talk with you and have your thoughts shared with the listener/viewer. But I want to start with a simple question. What is doubt?
You answer. it's uncertainty. It's lack of absolute conviction. It's a journey. You know, I think, what does James say? The doubter is like the one who is on the sea and the waves are tossing him to and fro. So it's a journey. Faith is a journey and doubt is part of that journey. And it's like being on the sea, that you're going up and down and and you're not sure. I think all of that is doubt. I think there are different kinds of doubt. But I think to start with, it's hesitancy. It's lack of certainty. It's reality. Can I say that?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what it is generally. Think about this. I'll throw this back at you because I think there's a couple of aspects. Now let's get into the realm of Christian doubt, and then we'll do some other things as well. There's intellectual doubt, or call it mind doubt and heart doubt.
Okay.
The mind doubt, I mean, there's a lot about the mysteriousness of the Christian faith.
Yeah.
We believe in the Trinity. We believe in Christ as fully God and fully man. We believe that God created the heavens and the earth. You know, so those are the intellectual doubts that sometimes the college student would go that way. But then there's the emotional doubts. you're praying for something. Our subject a couple of weeks ago was prayer, and you're not getting any answer right. whatsoever.
Right. I've experienced that.
Talk about it. I mean, it's okay to doubt. You could either doubt that God's good, or doubt God's there, or God cares, or right?
My daughter's been having ill health for several years, and I just kept praying and praying and praying, and God did not answer, still has not answered the way I want, at least. There are many other things that are happening that are miraculous about it, but there was a time that I actually wondered, am I just talking to myself when I'm praying? Literally, was I...
That's doubt.
Is this a joke? Mm-hmm. Have I been following this thing called God for all these years, and he doesn't exist? Yeah, I asked him that. Do you exist? I'm serious. I couldn't...
If he answers you, then you know he does.
Yeah, that's true. But if he answers no, what am I supposed to say?
That means he does, but he doesn't want you to know him.
That's right.
He's playing hard to get.
Yes, he is. Anyway.
So intellectual doubt and then heart or mind doubt, heart doubt is all of those things. And heart doubt can then even go into, again, it's not the intellect. It's not like someone has disproved the Bible, but like I was just talking with someone in their 20s who have somewhat walked away from the church. And the issue that they're dealing with when they were honest with it was the youth pastor that they looked up to for so many years. Now he learned the youth pastor was having an affair with one of the mothers in the youth ministry. And so he, in a sense, for now, I don't want to say he's done, but he's certainly doubting everything he believed.
Okay, so how do you get out of it? I mean, you can't spend your entire time believing in him still always doubting. There has to be times when you're absolutely, you know, stuck like glue to him and you know,
right,
yes, he exists. And it's not always when there's a joyous moment. You right. have to experience him when it's a dark moment and you feel very lonely and you
yes.
feel that even he doesn't understand, but you know he's there.
Yes. And yeah, let's talk about this then. Let's talk about the journey. And I think instead of faith and doubt being enemies, doubt is one of those pit stops on the journey of faith. It's there.
Yeah.
They're not opposites. Now, but faith is on a journey. You talked about, you know for certain he's there. That's what I would call the myth of certainty in a sense. The Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 13, remember, love is this, love is that. And then he says, now we see, I'm going to use the old King James, now we see through a glass dimly. He's talking about the way we look at life now is a foggy mirror. We don't see it very clearly, mm-hmm. so we have to live by faith. Mm. Now we have to look through a glass dimly. But then we will see face to face. Then we will know even as we are known. So certainty is not a thing in this life of faith.
Correct. Correct.
It's not coming till then.
Right.
And so you got to live with that doubt. You've got to live with the lack of certainty. And you can grow in it little by little. Here's one of the things that helps. Let's talk about this for a second. Doubt is so common that it's absolutely biblical. And Bible right. characters, again and again and again, you see them having doubts.
For instance?
Start of the first book of the Bible. Eve.
That's pretty early.
The serpent comes to Eve and says, has God really said that you cannot eat from any of the fruit of the garden? And so immediately, again, sometimes doubt can be the plot of the enemy. I don't think always, but it can be. And see what doubt is? He's calling into question, calling into confidence. Has God really said, calling into confidence God's word, calling into confidence God's goodness, mm-hmm. and calling into confidence God's motive? Because the enemy then says, he's afraid you're going to become like God, like him.
Right.
And so right from the beginning, Eve. Then you have Sarah. Remember Sarah, right. Abraham's wife? Abraham was promised that he'd have a bunch of kids with Sarah. She's 90 years old. You know how many kids she had? Zero. So then when she's told verbatim, you are going to have a child. Remember what she does?
Yeah, I do. She laughs.
She laughs. It's the laugh of doubt. It's like, come on. 90-year-olds don't have kids. That's doubt. Job's wife. Remember, Job goes through all that suffering and everything.
Right.
Loses his family, loses his finances, everything, health. And remember what his wife says?
What?
I'm going to Bible study. I'll see you later. No, she actually says, curse God and die.
Okay.
It's pretty strong words of doubt.
One of my favorite examples, if I can use the word favorite, is Zacharias, John the Baptist's dad.
Yes.
Who he doubts in front of the angel, and the angel says, okay, you doubt? I'm going to shut you up for 9 months. You can't talk. That's pretty impressive.
So God pushed the mute button on him for 9 months.
Right, right.
Well, remember his son, John the Baptist, who was the forerunner of Jesus. I used to... Do you watch the late night talk shows now?
Yeah, once in a while. They're not very good anymore.
So maybe you know who they are. I don't know any of them. I know a little bit. I was a big Johnny Carson fan.
Oh, so was I. They all pale in comparison.
Yes. Yeah. So this is going to sound blasphemous, but this is a fresh take. I used to call John the Baptist the Ed McMahon of the Bible. So who was like, who had Jimmy Kimmel?
So was he always drunk then? Or something?
No, he actually only ate locusts and went around in camel hair.
No, I know what you're going to lead to. I don't know who that guy is, but I know what you're saying.
Yeah, so they all have that guy. Well, John the Baptist was that guy for Jesus. Well, because of his association with Jesus, he gets thrown into prison, and he's soon to lose his head. But while he's in prison, he sends a couple of his disciples to Jesus asking this question. Are you really the Messiah? Or should we be looking for somebody else? Well, what's that but doubt?
Oh, yeah.
All that to say, it's common.
Can I throw something at you? Do you feel that sometimes when you're going through that period of doubt, that when you come out of it, when something either miraculous happens or it's just a gradual re-interest, that's a terrible word to use, but it's back into a sense of comfort with him, that you are... even that more mature or full of wisdom because of it. You went through a trial, you came out on the other end not having the doubt anymore and realizing that he truly is God, that much more intense.
Indeed, hear that. I think that is a real key, because if doubt is part of the journey, one of the rest stops on the journey of faith, God has his purposes. And at that rest stop, or the many, many rest stops of doubt, they can grow you, they can mature you. Because remember, if it's a journey, when a person comes to faith in Christ, they're at a particular point in their life. They might be a lot younger, life might be a lot happier, life might be a lot simpler, all of those things. I mean, think of Sarah. Abraham, her husband, says, we're leaving the Ur of Chaldees and we're going to the Promised Land. Great. She went and she followed. Well, life happened, years happened, still no child. And so things are changing. John the Baptist, pointing to Jesus. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Okay, pretty clear, pretty simple, quite a bit younger. Now he's thrown in prison. Now all of a sudden it gets hard. And so in some ways, because faith is a journey and doubt is part of that, doubt comes because it's like, wait a minute, it's not exactly like it was when I first believed. Mm-hmm. Life is harder. The things I were taught are not necessarily the same.
Right.
And so it's okay, if you're watching this, maybe you have a 20-year-old in college or maybe a 30-year-old that's newly married and they're really doubting their faith right now. Remember, the faith that you gave them when they were 6 or 8 or 12, they're different now. So the questions that they're asking are different now. And maybe some of the answers you gave them didn't really hold water, whether it was scientific answers or political answers or worldview answers. But it's part of that journey. And as they come through on the other side, if you do, and if you do, the other side, I do believe there's maturity on the other side.
I'm going to throw something that's going to test your talents.
You have a guitar?
Yeah. You used to play bass in a rock band. Yeah.
I'll send you my autograph for $20. Just send it to a fresh take. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Anyway, in all seriousness, and I do mean serious, what about the man whose wife has been diagnosed with terminal cancer? There's no way out of this thing. He's going to see her die. How is he going to get out of that without a permanent sense of doubt, mm-hmm. that there's always that scar between he and his Savior, because he didn't resolve that. He didn't fix that. How do you do that?
Well, yeah, in a sense, and you know this too because of your involvement with other people, but I was about to say, welcome to my life. I mean, that's ministry.
Right.
I just got a call 2 hours ago from a man in one of my groups. His elderly father just fell, and he was doing fine yesterday. They had to make a decision not to save his life. Oh. I mean, so that is life. And so let's talk about both how to prepare yourself in life, but also how to sort of work your way through doubt. And it does start, what I would say, personally. So that man's life, whose wife that you just mentioned with cancer, before the cancer hit, you sort of hope he's got a pretty good faith. He's in the Word. He's in fellowship. This will be a time, whether it's your 20 or that man, for self-evaluation. Mm. What do you really believe? Where do you really have your hope? If you're a young person, if this is your child, or if you're watching, this is the time to ask, is this faith my own, or is it my parents?
Okay.
And so I think personal inventory is a really important thing when you're dealing with doubt. Doubt is often linked with fear. It's often linked with insecurities. And again, I don't want to do psychobabble here, but there has to be a bit of introspection when you're doubting about what's going on in your life. The other option is just sweep it through the rug and get on to the next thing.
Which is no good.
No, it's really no good. But then I think together with that, and you can speak to this a bit, is not only is it, so it is personal, but then I would say it's communal. You can't do this alone.
No,
if
can't.
It's a journey, you're journeying with others. Maybe think a minute, if you like, even talk about some aspect of your life that you've journeyed with others in your faith and in your growth and in difficulties that have helped your faith.
Oh boy, that's a tough one because it's, in all honesty, it's a little tough to bring up, but I've had depression for years. Mm. And with that depression, there has been many times where I'm alone in a room and I'm talking to him and I'm saying, why did you let this happen to me? Mm. The funny thing about it is, not at that moment, and sometimes not for a couple of months, when I come out of it, I have a deeper faith, and something strange has happened. I've realized how much more he loved me. Nothing has changed, really. Mm-hmm. I'm still fighting depression. Mm-hmm. But somehow or another, I know in that moment that it's different than it was maybe a month ago. Mm-hmm. And there's something to celebrate there.
And can I say
I don't want to say that, take lightly depression. It's right. Crippling. There's right. No question about it. But to know that there's someone there who really loves you right. And is completely aware of every thought you have in your mind, mm-hmm. whether good or bad,
yep.
is with him. He knows it, and he's going to be with you.
Okay, so let's stay with us, because you just described the personal part of it, that you get alone with the Lord, and you in a sense get a bit more confidence, even though depression can really bring about doubt. And yet at the same time, Mark and I are really good friends. He tells me.
That's what he says.
I pay him $20 a week, yeah. And this friendship.
Will you be my friend?
But that, in a sense, that's the communal part of it. When a person goes through doubt, again, you got to do some self inventory, but you've got to deal with it in a authentic, deep thinking community of other believers. You can't do it alone. If you're watching Fresh Take, and you maybe you're a member of Trinity, maybe you're a member of a church in Portland, Oregon, like Dan, I talked with you this week, stay in that community. Make sure you're dealing with real issues. Make sure you're dealing with biblical thoughts, but very deep ones, and never, ever be afraid to ask hard questions.
That's right. Don't be afraid to share. Don't be afraid to ask.
No.
Don't be afraid to talk about it.
Yeah.
Even if you don't get the right answer from someone, because sometimes Christians can be stupid when it comes to certain subjects.
Yeah.
Remember when I was one of the throes of depression, somebody said that I'm not praying hard enough. Mm.
You have my permission to slap the person that says that, by the way.
Oh, man, that's tough. But there are also people out there with wisdom and love that can really help you along the way.
And can I say one other thing? Because we've sort of attached our children to this. If your child has gone away to college or maybe come back from college and their faith is doubting or wavering or different than yours, encourage them to continue their journey, but they don't have to go to your church. They could go to a church that's of a completely different ilk. If yours is a more evangelical church, maybe they seek a charismatic church or something different. So your core of beliefs will not necessarily be theirs, which gets me then to the third point, and then we'll start wrapping this up. So personally, you got to do some inventory. Why are you going through these doubts? Communally, you've got to be part of a community of other people that love you and pray for you and care for you and ask honest questions back and forth. But thirdly, I'm going to use the word intellectually. Because our faith can stand the intellectual questions that we ask it.
Yeah.
But know what's the core of our faith. I don't know what denominations you're a part of, but some of our churches on a regular basis read the creeds,
okay,
the Apostles' Creed, the Nicene Creeds. Those are helpful in the sense that they sort of summarize the core of our beliefs. But sometimes our faith has been so abstracted and contracted into other things that, okay, so our children, maybe your children don't believe the creation story the way you do. God created the heavens and the earth. Let it stop there. Maybe your children don't believe the political views you have. Good, probably. But make sure that those core are central. Does that make sense?
Yes, yes, absolutely.
So as you even evaluate yourself theologically or intellectually, know what stays and know what goes. And hang on to those.
Have we covered enough that someone who's watching this can actually say, all right, I can live through the doubt. I understand now a little bit. I mean, have we reached that point, or do we need another 20 minutes?
No, I think we have.
Okay.
Could I recommend two books?
Yes.
One is by John Ortberg called Faith and Doubt, and the other is by a man named Swoboda, and it's called After Doubt. Oh. Both of those are really good books that deal with this subject much more thoroughly than we've just done. I'll say one last thing and then you can. The last thing I would say is, if you're in an area of doubt or in a season of doubt, and you've stopped reading your Bible, read it again.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, can I recommend one?
Please.
There's NIV and American Standard and, of course, King James and whatnot. Find the one you like that has the best to understand. But you gave me a volume of books. It's absolutely beautiful. I wish you could see it. It's beautifully bound, and it's the entire Bible, not on onion skin paper. You know, it's good fat paper. That's why it's so wide. But there aren't chapters and verses to it. So you can read the book of Luke and never be stumbling by letters and numbers and chapters and this. It's fascinating how much he connects one subject to the next in a very, very fluent and beautiful way. Mm. If you can do that, I recommend it, because it's truly beautiful.
It's what Mark's recommending is the English Standard Version. I forget exactly what it's called, but it's several volumes, and it's a beautiful way.
Yeah.
Choose one, any of those translations. Yeah. But go back to start. Just read your Bible devotionally, and it'll be food for your soul and even for your doubting spirit.
That's it for this version of A Fresh Take, and I hope that you are enjoying these. Well, maybe you're not enjoying them, but that's good if you're not sometimes, because it's tough being a believer. We're going to do this all the time for as long as we can find answers or questions to be answered. That's Paul Tartarelli. I'm Mark Pennell. Thank you very much. We'll see you next time.
So long.